Hi, today is May 26, 2024. I'm Todd Agasawara, and this is MobileViews Podcast 512. The good Dr. John Westfall is off on a super secret mission and not available for this podcast, but we've got a good crew today. We'll go around the horn, not alphabetically. I'm looking at a Hollywood squares right now. So going around the horn, Sven Johannsen, Don Sorcinelli, Stephen Hughes.
I'll take Steve to block, please.
I don't know what we're going to talk about today, except for this one topic that I asked my friends here to give me some opinions, some thoughts, and maybe talk me down from buying one, because I'm going to order one pretty soon. I just haven't decided which one yet. Not the Surface, I can tell you that much. Really? But and what I'm talking about is less.
That's what I'm leaning on. That's what I'm leaning towards.
I'll tell you why. It's in my show notes. But so what we're talking about is last week, Microsoft announced the Copilot Plus PC. Say that five times fast in a row. And at first, I thought, meh. And then I read more about it. Actually, well, that day, you know, I started, Acer sent me some product announcements and things. And I started reading about it and go, Despite my distaste for Windows ARM-based PCs, starting with a Surface RT, and I'm going to spit on its grave right now. Actually, my Surface RT still runs. But starting with the Surface RT, technically there was also an ARM Windows NT server, but let's ignore that for a minute. Despite my distaste for Microsoft ARM PCs, Surface RT, as I said a couple times now, and Surface in general. I've had three Surface Pro 4s all die on me. Exploding battery, dead system board, and then some kind of failure that we don't even know what it was. It just stopped working. At which point I said, get me something else. And I got a Lenovo. Now, this is at work. I am really curious about this, and I'm actually planning to get one. I just don't know which one. And I want you guys to either talk me out of it or talk me into a specific model, not the Surface. Oh, we lost Steve.
Oh, well, he'll be back.
Hopefully he'll be back, yeah. Fortunately, we can do that now that we've stopped using Adobe Podcast Studio.
Yeah. So I don't know which way to talk to you about it, because I'm thinking of getting Surface. One too, but it may be, but a Surface. Yeah,
That's fine.
The fold-over one, not the laptop.
Oh. Yeah.
But I'm more interested in the ARM part of it rather than the
Snapdragon, Snapdragon Elite.
Yeah, I want to see how that goes.
Well, you know? Yeah, I'm going to be honest. I looked at this as Microsoft finally found a way to really bring Windows on ARM into the mainstream. They found a rationale for doing it. And yeah, the first thing I can say is, yeah, Windows on ARM is a lot different now than it was back in the RT. And I'm talking Windows.
Well, what about the Surface Go X or whatever it was called? Wasn't that ARM based?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, the 10, but
The other thing to keep in mind is that I'm looking at the latest generation. I'm looking at the processors. I'm looking at, you know. It's like night and day.
Yeah. I'll stop you there. There was nothing ever wrong with the ARM processor, including the one with the RT.
But the latest gen is just some amazing. I mean,
But the problem was always Microsoft Windows on ARM. I was going to say a bad word. Redacted PC. You know, it couldn't run anything useful on RT, at least. The Office that was supplied with Surface RT, and it came with, you know, a version of Office, was so pitiful, so abysmally pitiful.
Yeah, I guess
awful.
I guess the one thing that kind of puts me off on it a little bit, I think it's, I've got a MacBook Air, and that's their big thing. We're comparing everything to the MacBook Air,
right?
Which is their Mac's, you know, Apple's low end thing for basic consumers that doesn't have a fan in it. That's really not made for pros or business, and that's what they compare it to. But I looked at, I use Office a lot, what Office apps has Microsoft made for to run natively on ARM? And I find it's Excel, OneNote, Outlook, PowerPoint, and Word. And I was looking around and I found back an article in Windows Central, July 2021, they had Excel, OneNote, Outlook, PowerPoint, and Word. So they've done a bang up job of getting their own products onto ARM. Now so you're running everything in emulation.
The interesting thing about this, though, and this is the part where I'm waiting for braver and richer people than me. I'm looking at you guys to buy one first.
Which screen are you looking at, Tom?
Okay, braver at least, or richer at least, one or the other. But it has this Prism emulator, right? Not Prism. Prism. I know my accent's pretty heavy, but Prism, P-R-I-S-M, emulator that's supposed to run x86 applications.
But they
maybe emulator's not right.
Well, I've had an emulator before. This apparently is a new one.
It's a hardware emulator, part of the Qualcomm Snapdragon X series chips. If that's not a mouthful.
Yeah. What do you think, Steve? Do you think that it's going to be? What do you know about it? I guess is my question. I don't know anything.
They're claiming that the Snapdragon chipsets are like 58 to 60% faster than the M3 powered MacBook Airs. Some people have done some benchmarks on it, and some of them they are like Cinebench and stuff like that. It goes back and forth between the M3 and the Snapdragon. But in like real world situations, I have no idea what it's going to be like. And then we also have the next generation M4 chip that just came out from Apple. So
I just got
probably going to see that. And I'd see that. I would go with that over because it's a well-known entity right now. It's right now. It's like, I'm going to take a chance on Snapdragon. Like you said in the past, it's like, okay, you got burned before with the previous Surface RTs. I mean, are you going to be the first one to dip into that? And at least right now they do have the NPU, which is that neural processing.
Yeah.
Everyone uses it to something differently. They call it like a neural graphics processing unit. And although someone else calls it neurogenic, I can't remember which one is, but most of them just call
it neural processing. That sounds like a skin NPU. Thing, but.
It's the new chipset that you need to run AI running in parallel without taxing the graphics processor or the main CPU. So right now that's considered an AI accelerator for what people want to do, but you can do that too in the cloud as well. So I mean, and is it really needed? Do you really need AI running on your PC when you use most of the stuff is used in the cloud anyways?
Well, that's the question, right? I mean, I'm both intrigued by that notion of a localized AI. And I should know that I'm so old that I remember when all AI was localized because there was no cloud. You know? So I'm flashing back 40 years into my past when I was a grad student with dark hair, working on these tiny little neural network concepts that are basically like toys to today's generation. But yeah, that's what I'm really curious about is what does it mean? So basically, there are like three or four things that are only going to be available on these Snapdragon-based AI Copilot Plus PCs. Something called recall, which is generating all kinds of consternation because it remembers everything you do for some amount of time. Co-creator, which I think is pretty cool because you can put a little doodle on, like line drawings, and it'll flesh it out into really nice drawings.
Do you want to go
for a very narrow audience?
Like what recall actually is? It's like pulling out that image where you take it and then it keeps it in the memory of what's on the screen. I mean, basically that's what it's doing.
And it kind of parses that image too, so you can search for things. Yep.
You can search for stuff. Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, which sounds really cool as long as it's, stays on my machine and there's a lot of people who talk about privacy issues, where you get a snapshot of your window every 10 seconds with everything you do, including the typing your passwords, which are normally got little asterisks on them. But anyway, there's a little button there that says show me my password so I know I did it right.
And as we get older, I press that button a lot more.
Yeah, I do too.
Yeah. And a cool thing about that recall and you do that that's what I'm saying. You do that search inside that window. So if you took a snapshot and you type in, a demonstration of a fish or something like that, and you type in fish, it would pull up.
And I've used that sort of thing fairly extensively on OneNote where you just drop slides on OneNote and you can search for words that are in the slide. It's a JPEG and it finds it. So I have no concern that doesn't work right. And then, Microsoft counters that with, well, it's very, very configurable, so that you can tell it not to save stuff from this app, or you can delete that stuff. But you got something, you know, saving a screenshot every 10 seconds. I can't get through my camera library and delete the stuff I don't want. I'm not going through every 10 seconds of my life and pulling out the slide that I don't want saved.
Yeah, I think that even though it's a, or maybe because it's a localized AI and
it's storage, localized for security.
Yeah, it's local. Yeah.
It's more secure in the sense that, you know, there shouldn't be a Big Brother thing unless Microsoft is lying to us or something.
Yeah, they have a restriction you can do inside a recall from taking screenshots of certain applications or websites where you can turn it off entirely. Yeah. It's got like sliders in there that you can adjust.
Personally, you know, and again, I've never had a good memory even when I was young, so this is not an age problem. It's just a me problem. I would love to be able to just, you know, like, what was I doing an hour ago or 2 hours ago? There was something I wanted to do. I remember typing something in, but I don't remember what. And I think that's just invaluable. So I'm kind of looking forward to that. And then it's generating all kinds of concerns, and people are saying, you know, this is the worst thing since whatever, you know, this is 1984. I think it's, you know, it's like a lot of things in life, it's good or bad, depending how you use it.
I think a lot of people who are screaming the loudest about that probably don't realize how much other things that are going on with whatever platform and tools they're using that they're being one. I'm sure they're the ones that probably have 57 home devices. Guys, we're living in that era, and yes, if something gives you a lot of options to turn off functionality, that's what you need to do. But don't immediately say, oh, it's doing that, therefore it must be inherently bad, because most times those same people that scream that are using other things that are just, if not worse, bad.
Yeah.
Well, I read this stuff on X, Facebook, Reddit.
Yep.
Concerned about my privacy.
In the workplace environment, every like chat program you're using now, either be Teams or Zoom, you record it all the time. You have a transcript that goes on. So whatever you say, what you're doing is being recorded. So
And we are recording this right now, just to let you know.
We are? Well, no.
So there's a disclaimer.
At
any rate, I think I'm looking forward to recall.
I see. I take this a step back because, like I said, great, all these neat little features and everything else. I'm just wondering if we're finally, thanks to the evolution of the OS, the applications, and the hardware, are we finally going to see Windows on ARM that provides us with the performance and the battery life that we've been waiting for?
Yeah, that's
for
the
years.
Thing, right?
This is what excites me the most about
Let me get through the other features. There's live captions.
And you got to buy one to find out.
Yeah. And there's live captions, cool. Which does spoken words to English subtitles. It doesn't say about spoken words to other language subtitles.
Translation. Yep.
And so, like, you know, for video calls, things like that. And then finally,
I posted a link to how you turn that on in Skype.
Okay. And, finally, there's something called Windows Studio Effects for things like this, too.
Is that co-creator?
Give you good lighting and so forth. And also an eye contact teleprompter. Huh. That's interesting. That'd be useful for this, because I'm looking away right now to look at my notes on the other screen. So, but getting back to what you're talking about, Don, and, you know, Steve and Sven are our hardware gurus here. The hardware is really interesting. Like you said, Don, you know, they're claiming like all day battery essentially. And they don't mean standby. They're talking like running video for like 21 hours or something. So I'm really interested in that. I'm interested in it being cool, and I don't know why my video got lost, but that's okay.
Well, yeah, because one of the things that it uses is an AI agent as well, too, that runs in the background. So I don't know how much processing power is that going to use, or that's going to be just catered towards the MPU, how they're going to be scaling that back, because that's one of the things that's going to be running for all these different functions to happen. And if you ever looked at your system processing usage, depending on what's running in the background, we don't know yet.
Yeah.
I also wonder about how much, you know, there are a good number of companies that are putting out ARM native stuff. I think Adobe is, and a few others like mm-hmm. that. But I got to yeah. wonder how compatible they are with things. I remember a long time ago that, you know, Microsoft had 32-bit Office and 64-bit Office, and they actually had their own recommendation is not to use the 64 unless there is some specific reason you need it. And the reason was because none of the extensions and add-ons were written for 64-bit. They were all written for 32. So I assume we're in the same situation now, that the native ARM things don't, you know, won't be compatible with all those extras that people tend to use, unless you're just a basic user, you know, and you never add anything to Word or Excel or whatever, you know. So it goes. I mean, if it becomes the standard, of course, people will write for it. But
yeah, so I, you know, being a fan of ARM on the iPad, which is unbelievably cool, almost no matter what you're doing with it. As some of you know, it's been since the first iPad, my theory has been that Apple is shunting heat to another dimension, to another universe, in the multiverse, a dead cold universe, and it's kind of heating it up, trying to bring life to it using our iPads. But this, you know, all of my Windows stuff runs super hot, or anything with Intel, including my MacBook Pro. I have a 2019 MacBook Pro I'm using to record this with, just because out of habit. And it's actually, right now, it's not too bad. I've gotten a little stand that might be helping. But, and then I'm also, by the way, as a side note, I'm trying to figure out why my camera died all of a sudden. It's a good thing I have another one in order. So my webcam is dead. But fortunately, I'm on a separate microphone, so that should be fine. Have you guys watched any of the mini reviews, or not really reviews because nobody's had it long enough to review it, but
I've only seen the brief stuff that people have with it, and none of the developers I know have got a hold of it.
Okay.
Some have been working on it, but they can't disclose some stuff because of some NDAs that they have coming
right
up,
right.
And I think that's probably come out in another press release or something they're gonna have coming up soon, about a month or two. But I do know that Best Buy has a promotion going on. You can get a free $500 TV if you buy a Copilot.
If you're PC. Part of Best Buy Plus or Best Buy right. Extreme or something, yep. But that's only $25 a year, so.
Well, worth getting a $500 TV, right?
I have a question.
A 50-inch TV. It's a 50-inch Fire TV, so.
I have a question.
$200 TV.
I have a question for you guys. So all of the Copilot Plus PCs announced are all notebooks or laptops, depending on what you call them.
Yeah.
Except for this.
No desktop PCs, mini PCs, you know. Do you have any ideas why? I mean, it'd be nice, for example, to have a $500 Copilot Plus AI PC for my desktop.
People have been talking about they'd like to see something in a Mac Mini format, you know.
Yeah.
And probably the reason is because it's not useful for desktop work.
Could
you buy a Mac Mini to put four monitors on it, you know, two, four monitors on it and actually get some real work done?
I don't. I mean, I have a bunch of nuts.
But you can do that with your laptop, too. You
just plug it in. My guess is that most production today is focused on laptop.
Yeah.
It's not that they're saying no to it. It's just, and you look at who's making Acer, HP, Dell, where their production lines are set up. And just from a logistical perspective, the easiest thing to first retool and get out the door is that market. I'm sure there's going to be, just like we saw with, the lightweight, the mini
small
PC. I'm sure there's a market for that, and they already know there's a market for it. It's just a matter of when they take time.
I'm the market. I don't want to spend $1,000 to find out I don't like something.
Well, right now the small form factor PCs are so cheap. They're between $399 to $500.
I got one for $150.
They don't require much fan on it, and they run really well. I mean, could see them switching to ARM, and they could probably, but they don't need the battery life. They don't have a battery in it unless they have a battery backup.
But there's really no need for them.
Yeah, you do got to remember the small form factor stuff. You'd still got to add a keyboard and a mouse and a monitor.
Which is fine.
And a camera.
I got all that stuff.
Microphone. I know. You know, a lot of people, not a lot of people do anymore, I don't think.
Everybody really? Got,
and laptops. Mm. I've got several desktops sitting around me here, but I'm.
And the reason I say that is, you know, with the possible exception of maybe like a college student or something, where they have, you know, limited space and everything, most of the people I know with laptops have, you know, have it sitting up on a stand with a second display connected to it, which is what I'm doing.
With a keyboard.
And maybe an external keyboard and a mouse. So, anyway, but I wish it were like there were a $400 or $500 mini PC form factor that I could just buy to play with instead of $1,000 or $1,500, you know,
Copilot. Not ARM ones. There's only one ARM one.
Yeah. Well, there is ARM?
One. Oh, yeah, there is one developer one that's like $800.
Yeah. So, oh, that's the other thing. The minimum RAM requirement for these plus PCs is 16 gigabytes, which is smart. You know, I can see why they need all that for what they're.
I thought it was interesting when you mentioned that, because I think it was HP I was looking at. They're doing an OmniBook and an EliteBook, with OmniBook is supposed to be the consumer version, EliteBook, the business, the enterprise version. The consumer version can go up to 32 gig. The business version, they're only selling up to 16 gig, which I found a little bit interesting. I was like, is that a typo? Are you sure that's what you're saying? But apparently, and I'm like, oh, that's interesting.
Yeah.
If anything, I would have thought it would have been reversed.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Businesses are cheap, you know, not by the.
Yeah, but
I also wanted to ask you guys about this. For the non-plus PCs, you know, for the minus PCs, the Windows Copilot minus PCs that we currently have, I keep hearing, especially back when I was working, and I only had 8 gigs on my PC, and I was perfectly fine and happy. Everybody's, oh gosh, I only have 16 gigs. I need a 32 gig PC. What is it you're doing? I mean, how many windows of solitaire can you have opened at the same time?
Oh, I can push.
Oh, you see the tabs I have. Yeah.
Never mind. I have multiple
browsers with tabs. Yeah.
Get those VMs all kicked up and
fired
up. I can see that.
That's my Surface 8. 8 gig.
Yeah. I back when I used to run, you know, VMs of Linux on my Windows boxes just to test stuff. Yeah, I would have. Mm-hmm. I would have done damage to somebody to get more RAM, but
I agree. Days? I mean, it for most people, 16 gig these days is absolutely fine,
bare minimum.
But but you can trust me that you can find a validation. It doesn't take much time to find. I can make a case for 32 gig pretty fast.
I think I get it. If you're running VMs or, you know, you're doing some kind bunch of containers, or if you've got a 16 million line Excel spreadsheet, which is a bad idea, in my opinion.
that's called pretending to be a database.
Exactly.
Playing
solitaire.
Or it could be an output of a log.
My mail.
You guys might remember that this was like 15 years ago when we were in Redmond, when the Excel product manager came out and said, "Hi, I'm the product manager for Excel, the world's most popular database."
that still gives me chills thinking of it.
Of course, if you got 64 gig in there and you knew a data dump, you know, you're crashing it. Dumps that file out there for you, that fills your drive up very quickly.
Yeah. And I think all of these plus PCs have 512 gig standard. No. I think that's the smallest you can get.
No, you can get 256.
Can you get 256? Okay.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Let me see what we got here. Yeah you, so can get,
you can get a couple of 256. Yeah,
256 at least. I mean, is the minimum I've seen.
But where does Surface Pro, all the Surface Pro. Images then, because you're gonna need a lot of space with all of that. But I know when I got my M4 iPad recently, I got, for the first time, I went beyond 256, which is what I've been buying for years now, and I got 512 because I'm starting to do more video stuff. This is Sven's fault. I went out and bought that Insta360 X4 because he bought the
Osmo
CG. Yeah. The Osmo. So then he peaked my interest in all this stuff. But anyway, so I said, I'm going to do video. I need more storage on my iPad if I'm going to do editing on there or even just fussing mm-hmm. with it. But so I'm really looking forward to this. I want to know how well Prism works. So again, I'm looking to one of you guys to go buy one before me. Tell me how it works. And also keep an eye out for the ARM, native software. I saw Microsoft announce, I forget who said it, but Adobe and a few other folks. I think DaVinci Resolve.
Mm-hmm. It's going to be the ones that are going to be interesting to me are how many vendors, and I just happen to know of one vendor who put it on the back burner and probably now are going, oh my gosh, that right driver level stuff that haven't been done. Because that's where you can't get away with it if you're writing at the driver level, and that's a lot of security and monitoring and agent based.
Yes,
they can't. Sorry, Prism isn't going to help them. They've mm-hmm. got to adjust, and so that's going to be where some of the issues might come in with these in the enterprise, because those things I was just describing are common for enterprise, endpoint, threat detection, things like that.
Yeah, for those of you who work with lower level code, in my day, I want to speak in a creaky voice. In my day, we had to write drivers and stuff in assembler, so sometimes in C, but
CXDX calls,
the compiled C code was like K, many K versus a couple hundred bytes.
Well, you learn about code optimization and memory when you program for assembly. You get into the how layer.
No, that was my only. I thought about this only because ironically I had a recent conversation in that realm, and the point that was made was that at this point they weren't supporting ARM-based Windows because they weren't getting a lot of requests for it.
Yeah.
And I'm like, and this was before all these announcements. I'm like, that could change pretty quickly.
Did any of you buy the Surface Go X with ARM in it? And Sven, probably. Sven,
did you buy it? No, I did not. No.
I didn't buy one.
Well, it wasn't. There was never a Surface Go that.
There was no, I had one trial for a few months.
Okay. I assume printers and all that, the normal stuff, all of that worked, right? It was just the vertical market stuff.
Probably. There was drivers for it too, but it was, again, it came down to applications. I mean, most of the applications that they're promoting for this too doesn't really apply to the business. It's more for the consumer.
Yeah.
So they're doing like video edit, photo editing, stuff like that. I'm like, DJing. I'm like, I'm not doing that at work. That's not what I do at my work. And then they had also one of the things they do have was pretty decent was that liquid texting. They had that example of too, where you can do markup with pen and stuff like that, which is pretty decent for doing multiple document reviews.
So I've seen that some of the devices have a touch screen, some don't.
Mm-hmm.
Some are options, I guess. Does it support a stylus of any kind, like a Wacom EMR or?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Well, I don't know about this, but the Surface certainly does.
Yeah.
Well, okay. Good point. Because I just see touch screen. It doesn't say, we support USI 2.0 or we support Wacom EMR or anything like that.
Well, this is, this is it. I mean, this is, I know, but it's got the same pen essentially.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm not sure about the ones they announced that are coming in. Was it June 18th? I think they had one.
Yeah, that's
Acer, Asus, Dell, HP, Lenovo, Samsung, all the big ones. And I'm sure they have a SKU that probably has that option for it. But
Well, it's certainly capable of it. I mean, the Surface does. I mean, you sort of have to buy the $449. You don't actually. Surprisingly enough, the keyboard that I've got here is supposed to work on it, and the pen says. No difference.
Oh.
The big difference in the new $449 keyboard is I can detach it and still use it.
You keep talking. I'm going to go bring you my Surface RT keyboard, and I'll show you something that will just amuse you.
Yeah. So the thing on the applications, I think the thing that bugs me is I ran through the short list of things that Microsoft said, out of Office, but I cannot find anywhere where it says things like Access, Publisher, Visio, Project, OneDrive, Clipchamp, Teams, and SharePoint work in native ARM. So
it should if it's web-based.
I'm happy that Adobe's working on it, but you know.
I've got the 2012 Surface RT. I spit on it. I'm gonna take off this is the fancy dancy keyboard, not the membrane keyboard that it shipped with. This is, I don't know.
It's flippable keys, right? With the backlight.
I don't know. It's clicky though, you know, if nothing else. Yeah. It actually moves. I don't know if you can see it on my can you see
there you go.
I don't know if this is mold or what. But that's what happened to my keyboard.
You're living in a petri dish. You know, you're a Hawaiian. What do you expect?
Yes,
after 12 years.
Yeah.
Bring that thing to Colorado. We have no moisture whatsoever.
You're lucky that thing hasn't attacked you in your sleep, Todd. Okay.
You know, it still boots. I tried it. I plugged in. It's god awful. You know, it's got the world's worst designed charging port. It's totally proprietary. It is unreliable. And after a little, even when it was new, I had to jiggle it to get it to charge. The battery's dead essentially, but it'll still work with a power, AC power. Actually booted up to, you know, IE6 or whatever it's running, since it never got an update at past 18 months of life. So again, am I bitter? Yes. Okay, so
I got a whole Nokia 910 or whatever that thing was. It was an RT.
That was pretty cool.
It was a nice, that's cool looking. Lower here.
So that's my Surface RT, Microsoft's first ARM laptop that I know of, at least. All right, so Sven, you're going to go for the Surface Pro?
I think that's where I would lean. And I think, you know, I've got it up in my little, I don't have it in my basket yet, but I do have it in my saved stuff, my cart. But I'm looking at the Surface Pro with the Snapdragon X Elite, not the X Plus, so the better one. I'm told, which lets me get an OLED screen, 16 gig of RAM and 512. Nice. If you pop it down to the Snapdragon X Plus, you can't get an OLED screen. So.
That comes with a Microsoft Pluton security processor, and
so that's kind of where I'm. And that's $1,500 is what that is. 16 gig, 512, OLED, X Elite.
Steve's got to get one.
That's with no keyboard. That's with no keyboard.
Oh my god!
That's just a basic. That's just a basic machine.
Another reason.
But I can use my. I can use my.
Oh yeah.
My old keyboard and pen on it. So
I'm going to guess that my Surface RT keyboard will not work on it. So
no, it will not. It will not.
That's just a guess.
But
Steve, you either personally or at work, you considering one or more of these? Not yet.
Nope. We haven't even moved to my Windows 11 yet at work. So
you can do that before October.
This June, so we have to transition. So that's good. That'll be entertaining.
I'm sure. And Don, any thoughts?
No personal purchasing for me at this point.
Yeah, I should note that Don recently became a grandpa, and I think that's where his money is. He's going to spoil that kid rotten.
Oh, look at that new cost center that just showed up in my general ledger.
Yeah.
I am looking at the least expensive one out there, which I think is pretty good. And that's the Acer Swift 14 AI. It's got the Elite X, Snapdragon X Elite. Yeah. The base model does not have a touch screen, but there's an option for it. And it says, I think it comes with 16 gigs of RAM, but it can be upgraded to 32. The storage is up to 1 terabyte. So it looks 2 USB-Cs, 1 type A. Wow, it's even got a headphone jack. Very retro. Wi-Fi 7. I don't have anything that supports Wi-Fi 7, so no big deal to me. I max out at Wi-Fi 6 in my home.
Yeah, Copilot key.
And a Copilot. Oh,
key right there on the keyboard. Yeah.
Ooh, yeah. I think it starts at like 1100 without the touchscreen and, you know, base model. So I might upgrade to the touchscreen if it supports a stylus of some kind.
Yeah, but, I think there's a lot of them that have touchscreens too. Each, I know like Dell has, I think they have 5 laptops that are coming out. I know one of them has a touchscreen, like a 14-inch one, the Latitude line.
I wish there were smaller models. All of them seem to start at 14 inches. There's no like, you know, 12 or 13 inches.
There's a 13. There's a 13 for Dell. XPS.
There's a 13. Oh, yeah, the XPS 13. That's, you're right. You're right. I did see that one. But I figure that it's XPS. It's going to be kind of expensive. You know, versus the Inspiron consumer grade stuff. Mm-hmm. Right. So aren't the XPSs commercial, not commercial, but, you know, for businesses? And the Inspirons for consumers.
That's how they market them, I think. But that's, you know, you buy whatever you want.
Yeah. Well, I mean, the price
is they're a little higher. XPS is a little higher. Mm-hmm. Higher end, better materials.
Yeah.
Thinner.
Okay. Who put this Best Buy thing in? That's pretty funny. Who put the Best Buy on?
I put that one in there for you.
Oh yeah.
So what was the deal with Sven and I were talking about?
I'm opening it up now. Best Buy. We are not sponsored by anybody, by the way. So, Best Buy. What are they doing? You get a free TV when you buy a Copilot Plus PC.
There's your secondary display.
Wow. 50-inch 4K display. That is nice, actually.
Yeah. I get the nice one with the Samsung, and then you get the Best Buy insignia.
Yeah.
For the other model, the Surface, HP, Lenovo, and Dell.
That's pretty good. Oh, yeah. But the Surface, I'm just looking at the prices again. So the Surface Pro comes without the keyboard, right?
That's correct. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The other ones, you get a keyboard and then, like, a touchpad or a mouse.
I don't know what to
say. You just, you know,
set the Surface Pro. The Spirit Airlines of.
Yeah.
you want a working screen with that laptop? That'll cost you
extra. Well, if you get the Surface laptop with Copilot Plus AI, right. I think that's like 1,000. That's a 13.8. ish, and it has a minimum requirement of 16 gig and 512 gig of storage. So that's another option too. I think if you upgrade to like $200, you can get the 1 terabyte of storage.
Okay.
And I think, and then at $300, I think you can get the extra, what they call the Elite chip, I think it is. You can upgrade for that.
That's a thing, right? It's going to be hard to decode all the configurations for this until we learn the lingo.
And you're not going to know what you're going to need.
Yeah,
because until someone does some benchmark testing, and I know, like, I think Engadget got some early, and a few other sites too. So we'll see what they have coming out soon.
Yeah. So, I guess many of these are going to be available by mid-June in the U.S. Yeah. I think Europe might get it first.
It's supposed to be.
Yeah. For some, I think Acer is going to release in Europe first, and they won't be in the U.S. till July. So. But I think the rest are in June.
Yeah, June 18th, I've seen a couple of places as well. Okay. General availability.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, I'm going to get Steve put in these other things. Autopilot V2.
Oh, believe it or not, it was me. Told you, Todd. No, I just wanted to remind people that Microsoft Build actually at least was intended to be a developer conference.
What?
Initially, yeah.
I know, but lately it seems like I don't know what it is anymore. It's becoming like tech ed again, just as confusing. It's whatever we can throw in there in a few days. No, there were some. I mean, it is still principally a developer conference, but and of course, because of AI, there was a lot of work around .NET and developer announcements with, you know, across development tools and technologies, a lot of enhancements for AI integration, C#, version 13, announcements were made. A lot of framework updates, ASP.NET, Blazor, .NET MAUI, and I still encourage anybody who does any .NET development that's interested in doing any cross-platform stuff, .NET MAUI is a lot of fun to work with. And you really can do some true cross-net stuff, cross-platform stuff these days, and it really works well. They also big push on .NET Aspire, which is it's basically tools and tech stack to help streamline the building of cloud native apps.
Is .NET MAUI the open source project that Microsoft brought into its fold a number of years ago?
Originally Xamarin was where its roots were.
Okay, so that's the one.
Xamarin was
because of,
and then they basically it evolved. And while Xamarin, the tool set still is out there, it's pretty much deprecated, and there's even migration tools to help you move over to .NET MAUI. But it is great. I've done some work with it, and it's really sometimes amazing to me how far that's come to be able to build once and deploy on multiple platforms. And I provide in the notes, there's basically a nice summarization in the .NET blog of all the announcements and updates that happened. Like I said, build, go figure. I was actually in Austin this past week with a bunch of Intune folks. We were all together, and all of a sudden we're like, oh look, there's notes about Windows Autopilot, which, for those who don't know, Windows Autopilot basically allows for enterprises to create a customized out-of-box experience. So essentially I can drop ship you a laptop, open it up, and I can tailor the out-of-box experience, not only in what you do and don't have to go through, but what apps you get, what configuration settings you get. Long time overdue, but .NET, Autopilot V2 made its debut, and there's some really neat stuff in that. When I saw it, it was funny. It just like sort of under the radar while I'm in, and we were doing some other things, but there were, like I said, these were all Intune people. I said, hey, did anybody know that Windows Autopilot V2 is announced? And everybody's like, what? So again, build, covers just about everything. But yeah,
I guess that the enterprises and small businesses don't need to ship a disk image to their vendor anymore to
No, as a matter of fact, we don't talk image anymore. We talk about provisioning.
Yep. Configuration provisioning.
Yep, exactly. And with the idea being that especially nowadays, when I send you a PC, it'd be the best scenario is I ship directly from the manufacturer to you at your home, and you sign in with your business credentials, your Microsoft account, and then the next thing you know, boom, 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 settings, whether it be backgrounds, papers, security settings, and then your applications you're entitled to automatically show up on the machine, and it's all done in real time. So the days of having to image on site are done. One thing about Windows Autopilot V2 that's a little bit different versus V1 is V1 did support Azure AD join, hybrid deployments. V2, they've gone strictly cloud. Good news is you don't have to use V2. You can still stick with V1. But the push again is, and I've worked with a number of companies that are trying to, at this point, if you've got it in the cloud and you've got your local AD, it just takes time to figure out what applications still rely locally on your domain in-house. But the goal is eventually to just migrate all to, and I keep on saying Azure AD, it's Entra, it's Entra Azure. Now.
Entra ID. Yep. Enter ID, which you need to have access to Windows servers in order to get logons for that too.
Yep. So
it's a hassle. Most people don't know it's there, but it exists. Same thing with the Azure virtual desktops too. That's where they're migrating a lot of this stuff too.
Yeah. But there was good stuff that came out. Like I said, what was surprising to me is build. Originally, there was that split up after TechEd used to be absolutely everything. Then you had build go. And And like now it seems like build is building into becoming tech head again, because we're getting a little bit of everything coming out of.
Well, I got to say, this is the first build in a decade that I thought was actually interesting.
Yeah.
Only because of the Copilot Plus PC announcement.
Yeah.
I didn't think I'd had any. I was going to not have a podcast without John, because I didn't think I had anything I wanted to talk about this weekend. And then I said, hey, I want to talk to my friends about this, you know?
Yeah.
And so thanks for joining me to do so. It was a real treat, especially Steve. I haven't seen you in a little while.
I actually watched that keynote twice.
Really?
I did. I kind of watched it, and I was doing something else while I was doing it. And it
And
I missed too much of this. I'm watching that again. You know, so there was some interesting stuff in there.
All righty. Well, that brings our pretty much all we talk about is Copilot Plus PC, which is just fine, because I learned a lot from you guys, and I think some of my hard-earned retiree dollars are going to go towards a new Copilot Plus PC. Thank God I renamed this to just AI PC or something.
It's shorter.
Right? Yeah, that's just too many words or too many syllables. So Sven Johannsen, Don Sorcinelli, Grandpa Don, and Steve Hughes. This has been MobileViews Podcast 512, and we'll talk to you next time.